Welcome back to Shop Talk. I'm Rieta Anwar-Cotillo, and we're still talking about the best way to buy or sell secondhand cars. And joining us, of course, is Paulo Subido. He is the associate editor of Top Gear Magazine Philippines. Okay, Paulo, let's go into the specifics of the things that we need to check out in a car we're considering buying.
Right.
Okay, so we talked about it briefly. Let's just go into more detail. You're saying we need to check for a collision repair.
Yes, we you really should. The car might look really nice on the outside, but if you open up the hood, you'll see that check to make sure that things are in place. And if you look closely, you can see if there was any repair done.
Okay.
And also, you can knock on body panels to see what they sound like, to see if it was dented.
Right.
They make nice, it sounds like a metal when it's fresh, and it sounds like a dull thunk if it has masilia, meaning the car was prepared.
Right, so that's like for the doors and like the trunk and the hood. But what about the floors? Because those can be really rusty too.
Yes, that's right. That's a really big factor now. Rust, actually. Our cars are really well made nowadays, but it is possible to buy a rusty car. And rust usually happens when a car is repaired or has been repaired. So you should look out for that. If you can, I mean, if the seller agrees to it, he should agree to letting you put the car up on the lift so you can take a look underneath to see the condition of the floors, because you wouldn't want one that was rusted away.
All right. And what if the seller refuses to do that?
Well, if a seller refuses to do these things, you just walk away, because he's obviously hiding something. So, you know, it's kind of iffy.
Right. Yeah. Okay. And we should also check for smoke.
Yes, that means if the engine's compression isn't good anymore, the smoke would be coming out. So that's one of the first things. Check for smoke, and when you're going on the test drive, make sure that you get the right amount of power. It feels powerful. If it feels kind of weak, that's a sign that potentially a large repair bill. Yeah.
Okay, so you want to stay away from that.
Yeah.
Okay, we talked about knocking on the panels to check for putty or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
And you're saying that we want the car to have mileage of between what and what on the
odometer. Like the average mileage that we run usually for cars in the city is about maybe 12 to 15,000 kilometers in a year.
Oh, okay.
So if the mileage of the car looks too good to be true, it probably is. So you have to look at the age of the car and see if the odometer matches. If it doesn't, there might be something wrong there.
All right, so there's actually some nasty people out there who do that. They open it and they turn it back?
Yeah, there are. Okay. It is possible. It can happen. So you should know. And you can see that. If the reading is really low and the car looks kind of old already, I mean, you know, obviously something's wrong.
There's something wrong there. Okay, and you're talking about the timing belt, which is a very crucial thing also to consider.
What
exactly is the timing belt? What does it do? What does it look like?
The timing belt is inside of the engine. It maintains a timing. So if that breaks, it's like catastrophic, because like your valves, lots of things can be broken. And timing belts are usually changed every 70,000 kilometers. So again, like, if the person doesn't have a service record of the timing belt change, you can add, if you really want to, you can have them open it up and you can inspect the belt yourself. And it has to look fresh. It shouldn't have any cracks, and it shouldn't stretch. It should still be pretty stiff.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right. So that's important, because if there's something wrong with that, everything else is going to go to the pot.
Yes. If that breaks on you, you're stuck with.
Right. And test drive, when we take it for a test drive, like how long, how far should we go to really get a good feel for the vehicle?
Try to have mixed conditions. Try to drive it in traffic, drive it on the highway if possible. And maybe a good hour, just as long as the seller, you know, you're buying the car, if he's serious about selling it, you can drive it as much as you want. You can even like, hey, I'll be the one to pay for the gas. I want to make sure that I'm getting a good deal. So I've had friends who've taken cars on the highway. Sellers are freaking out, but you know, they're happy with the car and they bought it. So
so it's sort of like worth that bit of
it's
trouble.
Worth it. And if they're selling, if they're really serious about selling the car, they should let you do it.
Right. And as you said earlier, bring a mechanic or a friend who really knows these things.
Right.
And make sure that friend or that mechanic is somebody that
knows what they're
that you trust. All right. So let's just say I have found the vehicle that I really, really want. Is it possible for buyers to get the financing on secondhand deals?
Yeah, of course, man. It's just as simple as taking out a loan in the bank.
Okay.
Right? That's it. That's
but you have to do this on your own, because I know when you buy it brand new from the dealership
usually
works it out for you, right?
Yes, they do. Pre-owned, in certified pre-owned garages, like in BMW, thereabouts, they take care of that for you too. But if it's like a individual seller, I think you might have to be the one to take care of that yourself.
All right. Yeah. Okay. And on the seller's end, right, what are the things that they need to have? You already mentioned they need to have, like, the service record done, all the papers, and that sort of thing. Is there anything else?
What's this? Yeah, the PNP and TMG clearance.
Oh, right.
Yeah,
okay.
That's another really important thing.
Okay.
And that depends now. Who's going to take care of that, the buyer or the seller? It depends on the arrangement. But usually, if the seller's serious about selling his car, he'll take care of that for the buyer to make sure that you're buying, like, a straight.
Okay, so let's say that, you know, we were able to transact and I bought a car from you, but at the end, maybe like a week later, I'm really not happy and the car is just not functioning the way I thought it would.
Yeah.
And it's really a lemon. What do we do?
That's why, I guess, to make sure something like that doesn't happen, you have to make sure that you trust the buyer as well. If he was recommended by a friend, maybe, you know, things won't be so bloody. Mm-hmm. if that happens. Currently, there's the lemon law that was passed already, but that's for brand new vehicles. For secondhand, buyer beware. You really have to make sure that you're getting a decent car. So, yeah, make sure, check, double check, triple check, to make sure that you're getting something that's
right. And
that's
on the seller's end, I guess, to protect yourself as a seller, it could be like on the sales contract or the deed of sale, right?
That right. Yeah.
There's no warranty, and you know.
Yes. Exactly.
That it can't
exactly.
Be, that exchanged.
Mm-hmm. Right. And if you're selling a car, you know, be decent. Make sure that it's in good running order at least, diba?
Right.
Yeah.
All right. And what are the best places to check for good secondhand deals?
Well, you can check the internet, ask your friends. Ask around, really.
Yeah, I think it's good
really
to ask friends, because if your friend knows someone who knows someone, I mean, you kind of more or less know the seller's reputation,
exactly.
How they drive, mm-hmm. and how well they maintain their vehicles.
So you're not buying from a complete stranger, you know. So
yeah, you can track them down.
Recommendations, man.